Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our last Carbon Talk of 2015. I'm Michael Small. I'm the Executive Director of Renewable Cities and Carbon Talks here at SFU, and I'm delighted to be able to host this event and today. It's on a topic which really needs no introduction. I'm anticipating more people will be coming. A couple of administrative announcements. Normally, we run these meetings, events, until 1:30. Try to keep them to an hour. Given the complexity of what we're trying to cover and the fact that we have three panelists, I've asked them all to be available so we can go till 2 o'clock if the questions and the discussion invites that. But if those of you who need to leave at 1:30, and I know a couple of you need to leave earlier, please don't hesitate to depart. We all know that people have got busy schedules, especially at this time of the year. So it really gives me a great pleasure to be able to host this event. Let me begin, as always, by thanking our sponsors for these Carbon Talks, the North Growth Foundation, the Pacific Institute for Climate Solutions, and, of course, Simon Fraser University Center for Dialogue, of which we're a part. And these are always videotaped, hence the camera at the back. So if there's something you want to go back and look at, or if you think this is worth recommending to friends, you can always, it'll be posted probably within about a week or so. Maybe given the holidays a little longer, but it'll be up visually, so you can take a look at it in the future. Tweeting is encouraged. Our Twitter hashtag is @carbon@COP21. I think it's up there on the wall. And questions can be sent to @carbontalks. I know we have got quite a lot of people watching this online. In fact, I'm very pleased that each one of these events in the last couple of months, and we've had, this is our fourth since September, has had an increasing number of participants online. So online participants, please do send questions or comments, because I'd like to bring them into the room if we can. I've also asked our speakers to speak more briefly. So the framing question that I gave to all of the three of you, and I'll introduce them in a second, was what struck you, name three things about that either struck you the most about COP21, that surprised you, or that in particular you wanted to emphasize to the audience. So, and we've asked your three panelists are Jennifer Allen, who's a senior writer for the Earth Negotiations Bulletin, which is in effect the Hansard of international climate negotiations. And Jennifer, I did glimpse once or twice running in and out of rooms and keeping track of what was going on in the big tent. Jennifer gave a talk in September about climate negotiations, so I'm very pleased that you're able to come on back and give a recap of what happened, how it all came together at the end. Second, my colleague Maren Smith, who's Executive Director of Clean Energy Canada, also part of the Center of Dialogue. I think this was your first COP. Maren, and Maren, I've asked Maren to talk a bit more about her interaction with the Canadian delegation and all the various provincial delegations, plus other points that you might want to strike you. And lastly, Brian Buggy, who is Director of Strategic Initiatives at the Vancouver Economic Commission and was very much central, he and his colleagues, to the City of Vancouver's presence. And Vancouver is the city, and Vancouver is the community, had a very active presence in COP. So I've asked Brian to speak to the business and engagement component, which was important for the VEC. And Brian, if you feel well-positioned, maybe a little bit more as well about what the mayor and the city was hoping to achieve, since you're the Vancouver city representative here. So we have global, national, and local. And I'm going to begin by actually giving you very quickly my own three impressions, since I was there too. The first one was just how big it was. I mean, physically big. 36,000 people, I mean, recorded at least in the newspapers. The actual conference delegation list had 30,000. I had no idea. I mean, I knew these things were large, but I had no idea just how cavernous they were at Le Bourget, the site, and how many different events are going on. So one of the reasons for doing this plural approach is that nobody had the same experience of COP as anyone else. It was, as one speaker I heard referred to it as a 30-ring circus, I'd say it was more like about a 60-ring circus. So the second one was the importance of and how much the private sector, in terms of the really big end of town, major global multinationals, were engaging and playing with that. Maren, you flagged that in one of your blog posts coming out of COP. You may well want to speak more about that. I'm sure Brian will too. But the third point, which I'd really like to emphasize because it may not come up, is just my total admiration for the people of Paris and for the French government. They did an absolutely masterful job in two ways. One, in the logistics of hosting this, and if you were, you know, a participant, the logistics look flawless, and that is not a given because past climate negotiations have often fallen down on logistics, and it can often be taken for granted. The transport moved smoothly. The security, you frankly didn't even notice the security once you were on the site. And when you consider the fact that this is a country which had, as we all know, a tragic and major terrorist assault 4 weeks earlier, and the capacity of the French government, led by the president and by their foreign minister, to both be dealing with a major domestic disaster and security concern, which would have unhinged any other country, and at the same time devote total concentration to bringing the world together and steering it to a successful outcome. So there are many other people who deserve kudos, but the people of France and the government of France on this deserve all the credit that they should get. So I really wanted to say that at the outset, and I'll stop there and ask Jennifer to be in.
I think you also maybe wanted me to just quickly highlight what the agreement is or says.
I'll take this, most of us, everyone will have read some media about it, but it's the things that you think in particular that maybe are most significant.
Right, because I don't recommend actually reading the agreement. as someone who actually has now had to do it a few times. So this ties into the first thing that I was surprised about. I did a bunch of scenario planning. What are all the possible scenarios that can come out of this call? And at the end of the day, I figured, okay, there's three likely ones. And what I thought was the most likely was a face-saving, brief political statement supplemented by a laundry list of things that they promise to do when they get the time. I thought basically it would be a non-agreement coming out, but there would be some sort of ministerial declaration or short political agreement, few pages, that would try to save face out of the COP. The second most likely I thought was a substantive agreement, and the third most likely was complete failure. We got the second. We got a substantive agreement, a surprisingly substantive agreement. So in this agreement, it's long-term, it's durable, and it'll be dynamic. So it's centered around five-year cycles, and there's two cycles. One is for mitigation. So every 5 years, countries are going to have to come back and say, here's my contribution to the international effort around mitigation, adaptation, finance, technology transfer, capacity building. And then halfway through that five-year mitigation cycle or five-year contribution cycle, there is a global stock take. So what are our collective efforts achieving in all of these areas? And that global stock take is supposed to then inform the next cycle of contributions. So it's these two interacting cycles that the agreement is really sort of built around. The other notable things, maybe I'll just touch on things I thought were a bit surprising, was that now we have a new global goal, a new global ambition for mitigation. So we're going to keep the world under 2 degrees, which that's the number it's always been since Copenhagen, 2 degrees. The new bit is and pursue or strive to make every effort to stay below 1.5. And that was a significant win for small island developing states and least developed countries. And that was something that there was a big mobilization around at the COP itself, at the meeting. Maybe people heard about this high ambition coalition that formed. And that was something that means something, and that was a significant pushback that a lot of other countries frankly didn't want to see, because we're already at 0.9 degrees of global warming. So to say we're going to try to cap it at 1.5 was quite surprising. Also in the agreement, it's surprising that there's very few new financial commitments. So the $100 billion by 2020, per year by 2020, that developed countries are to start to provide, that's not looking like it's going to be ramped up until 2025, when parties agreed that they would get together and come up with a new global effort. And that will be a collective effort, because one of the big issues was expanding the donor base. So developed countries will continue to provide financial resources, and I think the hot words that were kicked around for a while was, and other parties willing or in a position to do so, and that became sort of tacked on with more words to make it extra clear that that will be on a voluntary basis. I think that's sort of the key points of the agreement. It's supposed to enter into force in 2020. The actual entry into force mechanism is 55 countries that represent at least 55% of global emissions. And basically that means that you have to get the major emitters to go home and to ratify this agreement for it to enter into force. So it helps avoid some of the problems with Kyoto where the US didn't ratify. And so when you don't have the world's largest emitter on board, it's very difficult to have a meaningful agreement. So I think right now it's the US, EU, China, and India pretty much almost account for that 55. Maybe they're a bit shy as a group. So you need to get these major emitters on board for this thing to enter into force. And that will be the big chunk of work in the next 5 years. So I think the substantiveness of the agreement, that was one really surprising thing for me, that there was actually meat to it and that this is an agreement that will be able to be dynamic and be able to ramp up ambition, because the other rule around these contribution cycles is that the last cycle must be more ambitious than the last. So you can't backslide and say, okay, we're just going to do the same as last time, or we're going to do a little less. You have to have a more ambitious one every time. I think the second thing that I found surprising, and in a good way, I suppose, is the level of high-level political engagement. And this was 150 heads of state arriving on the first day of the conference. That's the first time that 150 heads of state have ever been anywhere in a UN system, not even the UN General Assembly. So that was significant. And then also significant is that they got them to leave. Because what happened in Copenhagen is at the end, you had 25 heads of state negotiate this Copenhagen Accord out of nowhere, and it was a complete train wreck. So they got them there on the first day, they provided some political statements, some political guidance, political will, and some flexibility to their negotiators, and then they left. So they couldn't actually sit down with a pen and paper. But that didn't stop Obama from spending about 2 days solid on the phone phoning heads of state. So on the last days of the conference, I kind of camped out outside of John Kerry's office to see what was going on. And it was a steady stream of ministers in and out from different countries. So the minister of Turkey walked in for about half an hour, walked out. Ban Ki-moon walked in for half an hour, walked out. The minister from India walked in, that was a good hour, walked out. Then John Kerry comes out and says, okay, where are we at with this? I need South Africa, I need this one, I need, you know, where are we at with adaptation? Somebody go get me Marshall Islands. And so he spent two solid days there just meeting with ministers to hammer out a deal. And then whenever he couldn't do that, he phoned Obama, and Obama phoned their boss. And so the level of political engagement at the highest levels was more than I had anticipated. And it worked. I mean, the U.S. kind of got the deal that it wanted. I can't think of any really major significant compromises that the U.S. made. They really did get their deal. And then I guess the third thing that I found interesting, and this is less surprising, but it's also something to look for in the future, is that this was a massive COP. This is the biggest COP I've ever been to. I mean, we joke about the size, but I had a pedometer, and it was over 900 steps from my office to the plenary, one way. And so, I mean, that's great, because I could eat a lot more chocolate, but the downside is you just lose people. And I think part of the losing people meant that a lot of the mobilization that was happening in these side events or in these other events around announcements from cities and from provinces and from companies weren't feeding into the negotiations to the extent that I actually thought they would. So Bill Gates makes a massive amount announcement around investment in renewable energy. And the negotiators, I think they probably heard it on the news, but in a smaller venue that would have fed in a lot more. And they would have sought to catalyze that a lot more. And so it was a bit of a shame that that got lost. You know, Quebec promised for the first time to, as the first subnational entity, to pledge money to the Global Environment Facility for the Least Developed Countries Fund. First subnational to ever do that. And probably walking down the halls, you would have no idea in the negotiation rooms that that had happened. The negotiations quickly, and this isn't surprising, you know, we expected it to happen, but they quickly went into informal bilateral negotiations amongst ministers or negotiations closed to observers. So most of those I could get into. And then, so that was useful because then at least my publication is a way to increase transparency. But even quickly, by the second week, we were being shut out of everything. And it's something that usually happens is there's this trade-off where if you have a group of ministers in a room and they're making a trade-off between, I'll give you more finance if you give me 1.5, they don't really want people listening to that. So it wasn't surprising. I was a bit surprised it happened so quickly in the process. I'm also surprised that the ministers decided to stay there all night. So the ministers were doing all-night negotiations and then all-day consultations. I was happy because that means I didn't have to stay there all night. But I think that was the last surprising thing, is that the side event announcements and the subnational announcements didn't feed into that process. And I think it's partly the size of the venue, but I think it's also that the negotiations were less transparent and less open and really sort of insulated from the rest of the 30 or 60 ring circus. So yeah, I think that's my three big things.
Thank you very much. I'll now ask Maren to give her impressions. I'll use that mic.
Okay. Well, you were sort of in the inner ring of the negotiations, and there was a lot of people there, and so I decided to go to all the outside rings. So that's where my impressions come from. So my first one was about business, and I think the quote that sums it up was John Kerry saying, you know, this is the biggest market opportunity that the world has ever known, this transition to clean energy. And Felipe Calderon, the former president of Mexico, who I was trying to remember what his title is now, but he's deeply involved in this as the head of some...
Commission,
yes.
New climate economy.
Saying, you know, 10 years ago I couldn't have said this, even 5 years ago at Copenhagen I couldn't have said this, but now the technology is ready for prime time, it's cost competitive, you know, this is a market... a good market, a good business decision. So there's no reason not to do this. And then it just went on and on. It was not just the renewable energy sector or IRENA, the International Renewable Energy Agency, just over and over again talking about the business case. But it was companies like IKEA and Patagonia, Facebook, Google. It just went on and on, senior CEO level, getting up there saying, the business case for this is this is the right thing to do. You will make money doing this. This is a good business decision. Forget about climate change. They didn't say forget about climate change. They said we're all here to support the negotiators, but this is going to happen no matter what comes out of the Paris Accord. This is moving forward, and what comes out will either accelerate this or, you know, it'll just be irrelevant, and we will plunk along and continue to move forward. You know, and really clear message, the first in are going to be the winners. There was a lot of different companies there from around the world, you know, Portuguese wind companies that are now global, Chinese companies, Swedish companies, German companies, no Canadian companies. Now, Brian, not to say that there aren't Canadian companies. There were Canadian companies there. There was no Canadian companies on the stage. There was no strong leadership from the Canadian business world. And as a Canadian, it was really striking, because everybody was so excited that Canada was back on a political level, like really warm reception. You were proud to be a Canadian because people were cheering, you know, that you were there. But in the business sector, we weren't even mentioned. My second, you know, sort of real takeaway was Thomas Friedman on the stage, you know, with the New York Times, and he has gone to a lot of COPs, said, I have never heard this word before at a COP, and I keep hearing it over and over again. Stranded assets. Stranded assets. It's not usually a word at a COP. And, you know, Mark Carney and Michael Bloomberg stood up, the Financial Stability Board, announcing a global task force to look at the risk to capital because of climate change. And they did that during the COP as well. There's, you know, I can't tell you how many times I heard CEOs, you know, and the heads of these institutions saying, subsidizing fossil fuels has to end. This subsidy for fossil fuels is, we are paying people to pollute. We are subsidizing the economy we're talking about getting rid of. This has to end. And, you know, I really also, to bring it back home, was like, this is not a conversation. Not only are we not having it in Canada, but if you bring it up, you are looked upon as some radical fringe element. How dare you talk about, you know, the financial support required for the oil sector? But I mean, here it was just really matter of course. Like, I mean, this is ridiculous. This is absolutely ludicrous that we are subsidizing this fossil fuel industry.
I even heard a fossil fuel company say that.
Yes. The CEO of Statoil said that as well. We need to get rid of the fossil fuel subsidies. So that was exciting. The financial conversation and the last piece of that financial conversation was putting a price on carbon. And I think one of the things that really struck me was a speaker who said, by 2020, 90% of the global GDP will have some form of a price on carbon. Those commitments have already been made. We need to stop about putting a price on carbon. We need to start talking about putting an effective price on carbon, a high enough price on carbon. Like we've moved past the we need a good price on carbon. So that was surprising. Again, not a conversation. It's growing here in Canada, but it was very prevalent there. And the third thing that really struck me was the repetition about this isn't about sacrifice. This isn't the Jimmy Carter era where you're talking about turn the heat down and put a sweater on. This is about a fantastic future. This is about a better future. We're going to have, cleaner air and less premature deaths related to air pollution, less medical and hospital financing because of air-related diseases. We're going to have less congestion in cities, and we're going to have healthier lifestyles for people with walking and transit. This is about a better future. And there was a really interesting, I think, juxtaposition of, what has happened in the tech sector, where we have really shifted to communications around the world, globally, bang, there is one system. You take your iPhone from China to Vancouver to Paris to South Africa, there is one system and your iPhone's going to work. You take your iPhone charger from Vancouver to Paris, you can't charge it. You got to have this adapter and this whole contraption. Then you go to China, you're going to have something else. Like, the electrical system was built in the era of our grandparents, and it has not been updated. If you look at what happened with the communications technology and how the systems changed, we need to be thinking about what's going to happen in the energy system. We're thinking of it in the old utility, big utility controlled systems. And nobody there really had the answer, except that the future is going to look very different. And if you look at the energy companies of the past, even if you actually looked at the stature of the people on the stage, the CEO of Total and the CEO of Statoil versus the CEO of Facebook and Google, who are now, it was pointed out, Google, Apple, these are now energy companies. They bought Nest. They are buying into these systems. The energy of the future is about smart grids. It's about smart homes. It's about smart cars, things that are technologically controlled. And there's a whole new group of actors that are already coming onto the scene but are not being considered actually as the energy players. And they operate in a very different way. They're very tuned into millennials. And millennials want a future that the product that they're buying has been produced in a socially and an environmentally sound way. And so this conversation wasn't fully baked. It's just more, this future is going to be taken over by various different things that are not part of the energy past, and their technology, and they're going to operate in a new way, and this new world is going to be better. It's not about sacrifice. So that's probably my three takeaways.
Thanks very much. I'll make a comment by way of giving an opportunity to people who are sitting on the side, if you'd like to take seats, because we do have seats, if those of you are standing. But let me just interject that I was at the Mike Bloomberg, Mark Carney talk. I would hope somewhere, because there were 30 TV cameras on them, that somebody's recorded all 45 minutes. I can only find 7 on Facebook, at least on YouTube, pardon me. But it's well worth looking at. And the ground has started to shift when, first of all, you see those two, literally leaders of global finance there. Carney was there under a remit from the French government through the G20. G20 are the 20 largest economies in the world, to look at climate, the climate risk to the financial system. And at one point, when it turned to the public and journalists asked him, stood up and said, "Mr. Carney, you're the first central banker who's ever attended one of these things. Why are you here?" And he looked at the questioner, not as if to make them feel completely stupid, and he just sort of shrugged his shoulders and said, "Look, the organization I represent, the Financial Stability Board, was here to examine global systemic risk to the financial system. Well, climate change is another global systemic risk. Why wouldn't I be here?" And, you know, the kind of aha moment, you know, going through. So just to reinforce, you know, some of the points that Maren just made, that the ground was shifting. With that, Brian, maybe you can talk about the Vancouver dimension and the business dimension as you saw it.
Sure. So let's get local. Is just show of hands, everyone from Vancouver? Does everyone love Vancouver? Right? So I was... Probably during that 1 week we were there from a Wednesday to Wednesday, you couldn't find a more proud Vancouverite than Brian Buggy. I just was amazed at the presence that Vancouver had. So my first point was Vancouver was everywhere. So we had four people from the city, including the mayor, and four people from the Vancouver Economic Commission. And we had a jam-packed agenda day and night. I didn't even see Paris. We were so packed with opportunities to meet with business, get in front of large audiences, get our message out about the green economy and all the benefits that it's bringing to our local economy. And, you know, quite frankly, the mayor of Vancouver is a rock star. He was asked to speak in a huge variety of events, including a rock concert on a Friday night, of all things. I'm standing amongst all these rockers down below, and there's the mayor on stage talking about Vancouver. It was remarkable. He had more than two dozen opportunities to speak in front of audiences, interviewed countless times. Our CEO had similar experiences, although not nearly as many. We had if I try to go in chronological order, we won an award on a Thursday evening. We won an award through C40 for the Greenest City Action Plan. And to be in a huge audience in Paris to be acknowledged for the Greenest City Action Plan, which I've personally been working on for 5 years, was incredibly gratifying that it's getting that kind of profile globally. We also had a Vancouver-based company called Plastic Bank mm-hmm. take away a really important award called the Community Award at the annual Sustainia event on Sunday evening. And there must have been 500 highly influential senior executives in that room watching a Vancouver-based company collect this award. And of course, there's a few people from the VEC there, and he was just delighted to know that Team Vancouver had shown up to support him and his moment of glory. We had Canada Night on Monday night. Mm-hmm. Maren was there, and she knows, because I put one on her. I walked around. We had probably, how many people were there? 500? About 500 in this room. Three premiers showed up to speak. We had several ministers speaking, including our own BC Minister of the Environment. I had these stickers called Building a Green Economy in Vancouver. I was just going around and slapping them on everyone's lapel. By the end of the night, it felt like Vancouver night. You know, Quebec was really pissed off. So we had a lot of fun with those sorts of things. We had another event at the residence of the ambassador where Catherine McKenna came and spoke to us. And again, I just another proud moment. In this case, not just a proud Vancouverite, but a proud Canadian to see Catherine McKenna really take this on. And just a couple days prior, when I was bumping into cities all over the world, which is my focus, I want to learn from other cities what they're doing, especially the Nordic countries. They were telling me about what a great stand Canada had taken by announcing 1.5 degrees. And I heard it from them first. I was too busy to be following the news. And I'm thinking, are you kidding me? Over the past 10 years, the reputation we have, and we just turned on a dime. Canada really is back, just in that one statement. We didn't collectively, globally, get to 1.5, but Canada was acknowledged as really taking a stand amongst the G7 to say this is where we need to go. So, you know, point number one, Vancouver was everywhere. I don't know of any other city, and I'm Vancouver-centric and selfish and all that stuff, but outside of Paris, I'll ask this panel right here, did anyone hear about another city or even a subnational region that got as much profile as Vancouver?
No, nowhere near as much.
California, definitely.
California is a region, but
I know,
as a city,
said
no.
Subnational.
Yeah. That's pretty tough competition. Anybody else? So, yeah, we're in the big leagues. So that was a really proud moment, and everyone in this room should be proud of the profile that Vancouver's getting. So point number two, green means business. It's been talked about a lot already. I'm going to just rattle off a list of celebrities that I was very fortunate to either meet or listen to, including Leonardo DiCaprio. He did a shout out for Vancouver specifically. At an event he was involved with. John Kerry, Jerry Brown, the Secretary General of the OECD, the Secretary of State for the U.S. Energy, Bill Gates, Richard Branson, Ted Turner, Mark Carney, Michael Bloomberg, Thomas Friedman. We had a meeting with the CEO of BMW. You really get the sense that, you know, we're about to experience a bit of a breakthrough in what it means to grow and develop a green economy. And conversely, if we were leading, and in many ways we are, this has become our race to lose. Not that I'm competitive, but we're a pretty small city, and there's some huge opportunities to really take the bull by the horn, but we don't have near the budget or the scale that these major cities or corporations around the world have. And as they're waking up, we as collectively as a business community need to figure out how to take advantage of those opportunities. So we're talking now to much larger players and much more significant. So in this meeting, just as an example, and we had many of these kinds of meetings, but with the CEO of BMW, he kind of got the sense that he'd never even heard of Vancouver. Or if he'd heard of Vancouver, it was his moment of wow. You know, he was delighted. He had no idea of the culture and the programs and the initiatives that we've already got underway here. He wants to come and check it out, and he wants to bring, we're hoping that we could get, say, an I3 fleet in a car-sharing model to land here in Vancouver, just as almost as a showcase to say, you know, this is part of the future and where we need to be going. So green means business. The third one is just getting back to that policy framework, and we heard this many times as well, and I think Maren might have mentioned it as well, I think it was the Kyoto Accord, I think it covered roughly 14% of all GHGs around the world. That's ultimately was the outcome. With this new agreement in Paris, I think we're up to close to 95%. It was something like 186 of the 195 countries that were at the table signed on to the agreement. You would know the details better than I, but that's quite a significant shift. And so, you know, the large corporations and smaller businesses right here in Canada look at this messaging and say, okay, you're giving us a sense of direction, you're giving us a sense of security that as we shift and move in this direction, we feel safer about placing our bets, our big capital infrastructure bets. Feel more secure now when we have this framework in place that looks pretty solid relative to the past, and we can acknowledge there's still a lot of work to do. So that's really important to the business community globally, and I think this really sets us up for some breakthroughs, I think, in the short term. So I couldn't be happier, I couldn't be more excited about the future of the green economy here in Vancouver, and I think we're going to continue to grow our green entrepreneur base here. We now employ more than 20,000 people in green jobs. 1 in 20 Vancouverites has a green job. generating more than $1.9 billion annually in revenues now. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. It's just going to keep getting better. So I think I'll stop there.
Great. Thank you very much. Well, to kind of summarize a couple of things, the world achieved a much more ambitious agreement than most people expected. Global business was there in a huge way and clearly committed. Vancouver was extremely present. Canada as a country was back, but the Canadian business community, maybe not so much.
Well, the Vancouver business community was
clearly
there.
The Vancouver business
we
community.
We had 24 Vancouver organizations
Absolutely. I wasn't meaning to subtract at all from what the city and our business community here was doing. But I noted the same thing as Marin did, is that I didn't see, with the exception of Canadian Solar, who were a sponsor of the launch of an international solar alliance, which I happened to be there. That was the only Canadian firm of size and of economic importance in the sector that was active and present that I noticed. So, one can unpack that or examine how true that is. But at this point, I'm going to turn the floor over to the audience. Just quickly, I know there's at least one person in the audience who was also in Paris, but so that I do know, and who was actually at Paris this time? Let me just make sure I'm not missing anyone else. Okay, good. Questions, comments, please. Sir.
Yes, to Brian. As you know, the INDCs are going to take us as given to around 3 degrees, and I'm wondering what, now that the nations have promised to move towards 1.5, what Vancouver and our region is thinking of doing to bring down emissions, such as, what kind of things, perhaps around transportation, like electrification of vehicles and so on.
Yeah. So we have the Greenest City Action Plan, which is well underway. We're 5 years in, so halfway through, and we're doing pretty well on all counts. On all 10 targets, we're moving the needle. And, of course, just recently, within the last couple of months, City Council has passed now a motion to become 100% renewable by 2050. That's not just corporate operations, it's the entire community. So it's all of us that live in the city. We'll be using renewable energy and with also a goal of reducing greenhouse gases by 80% over 2007 levels. So we need to be shifting our thoughts from sort of this broader Greenest City Action Plan and getting very focused on energy. So we have a lot of programs that's going to stimulate innovation, stimulate more green jobs. We're doing it right now. We have a demonstration program in place to allow entrepreneurs to leverage municipal assets of all kinds, including infrastructure, buildings, fleets, underground infrastructure, street transportation. But now what we should be thinking about is if we can't attract certain entrepreneurs to do these kinds of demonstrations, then let's go pursue them and let's make sure it's about clean energy. It's about very specifically targeted to those carbon-intensive parts of the economy. So it's not just, water. We're doing okay on water. We're doing okay on clean air here. But it's, I think it's around 24% of our greenhouse gases in the city come from transportation, 45% or 44% come from the built environment, and that remaining 31% is indeed clean energy today. So we still have a long way to go. We also are leveraging municipal assets to develop an innovation hub, and we hope to put a clean tech accelerator in there. So these sorts of things are supporting our startups, supporting our early stage companies to grow and eventually get to the export markets faster. And we hope that we can start to change some of the municipal constraints. We have a constraint with NAFTA. We have public policy procurement constraints. We've got other legal issues that make it very tough for our local entrepreneurs to sell to our local municipalities. We need to do something about that. I think the pressure is greater now than ever to review procurement policies, to really figure out ways to open up the public powers, not just the city, but the province as well, so that we can get our local entrepreneurs more engaged here locally. So I'll stop there. There's a couple of anecdotal stories, but those are the sorts of things that we need to be working on right now so that by, say, 2030, we're really rocking.
Quick comment, which is I don't think that the international system has yet worked out how, in fact, the actions of cities or regions aggregate into the national INDCs. That whether there's a common methodology or individual country like Canada takes that on, but it has every interest in doing so. But the 1.5 was a significant development, and I actually would like to ask Jennifer if you could just comment a bit more. You alluded to it in your talks about the significance, or what significance would you attach going forward to the fact that it made it into that agreement, which was not anticipated beforehand, and how is that going to affect negotiating dynamics? Because we all know the existing INDCs don't even get us to, they get us maybe slightly below 3, so we're a long way off 2. How is that going to set up for potentially for future failure, or is that going to be more of a spur to action, do you think, in subsequent years of negotiation?
Sure. Just in case, I know INDCs are a pretty famous acronym, but don't get too attached to the I, because they're, once this agreement's in effect, they're now NDCs, so nationally determined contributions. And that actually wasn't going to be, that wasn't a slam dunk either. But the idea is that they are intended now, and countries have signaled this is what we intend to do when the agreement enters into force. This is what we're signaling we're going to do. And there's 187 of them, representing roughly 96% of global emissions. And more significantly, every major economy has put forward an INDC. But when we drop the I, it means that the contributions that countries will put forward when they ratify this agreement may or may not be the same as what they've already put forward. And so I talked to several delegates when it looked like 1.5 was going to get in there that said, we need to take this home and look at, do we need to ramp up the ambition of our INDC before it becomes our NDC and we put this in the agreement? So I know that some countries are already looking at what can we do to actually improve the ambition of our INDC, soon to be just, I'm just going to say contribution, put forward and in lieu of the 1.5. So I think that's one big signal that will have more immediate ramifications. I've also heard a lot of businesses or a lot of people saying, look, this is the signal to business that this is getting really serious. That it's not just that developed countries will be undertaking potentially massive reductions, but that developing countries, particularly less developed countries, are going to be looking for a leapfrog model of development, one that goes over the fossil fuel model and into clean energy immediately. And the amount of investment and technology required for that is absolutely unprecedented. You know, we're talking about 100 countries. Exactly. We're talking trillions of dollars, hundreds of countries needing to switch immediately to decentralized renewable systems. And so the 1.5 number really signals that we actually can't do that without a lot of countries on board. And so that sends an even stronger signal to business that this is truly a global effort. And it also just signals the urgency of the problem. So it was small island developing states that were really the catalyst behind this and have been working since 2009 to get 1.5 in there. And so it really is a signal that, you know, at 1.5, some countries cease to exist. And so it's as much a signal to businesses, but also a signal of the rights of some countries and of the urgency of the issue.
Just, I'd like to go ahead, Brian.
I'm just going to add, when I hear her talk like that, and I went through a week of hearing those kind of messages, I just keep going back to the business opportunity. Are you know, $1 trillion going to, you know, less developed countries that probably don't have the expertise to do that? So I'm hoping that those are Canadian companies, those are Vancouver-based companies that are heading down to those less developed countries to deploy solutions that were made right here in Vancouver. So these are extraordinary times for Vancouver entrepreneurs or Vancouver companies.
The Plastics Works company that won the award would be a good example of that. Shauna.
I had a chance to sort of look at what had gone on from 1992, the Rio Summit, through Copenhagen to here. And there were some patterns I want to, and Jennifer, this is really for you because you've watched this for so long. I mean, definitely green equals smart, no doubt about that. The rise of the private sector. But there were some things that I'm still reflecting on. and I'd like some guidance on that. I saw, especially with the carbon project report, that we were seeing the leveling off and decreasing on GHG emissions. The message from that report was nation states are 15 years behind. So one of the questions I want to ask you is, going forward, what have we, have a nation states devolved so much of their capacity to decision-making that they are making themselves somewhat irrelevant in international negotiations? So that's my first question. The second was, I couldn't believe the difference in the conversations around developing countries. I almost wanted to say green is the new colonialism, and we've been saying that for a number of years. I mean, that goes back to Rio Summit, and, you know, there's no... saving the planet can be an incredibly powerful force for centralizing how that will be done. So what I saw was, I didn't see the conversations happening around the traditional blocs in developing countries that you would normally see. I saw developing countries as centers of innovations, new market opportunities. And so I want to get a sense of how the traditional North-South played out. And then the final piece is, I have to say, I walked away in Copenhagen from the Klima Summit because it became such a socialist pronouncement. It was every single day, down the corporations, down the corporations, down the corporations, which that has a following, and it was such a negative messaging. I didn't expect to hear that in the same way as I did hear it again. The ENGO community seemed really divided. And I want to get this in Paris again. You had the strong eco-warrior. The only way we are going to get there is through being into civil disobedience. And then a very different kind of ENGO community working with all of the others saying, you know, that fight around stranded assets, we want it, kind of. And now it's really implementing and moving forward with the green equals smart. So I want to get a sense of that. So three different dynamics that I saw, and I haven't landed on any one of them, and your impressions of that.
Give either of you a chance to comment. Jennifer?
I mean, I think all of those trends are spot on. In terms of states being 15 years behind, it's sort of yes or no. So the UNFCCC process is divorced from reality.
Spell it out.
Yes. Even worse, I won't say UNFCCC. I won't be that lazy. So the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, the hub where the negotiations happen, that is, it's in some ways behind, and it also doesn't reflect the reality even of what states are doing. So for example, China and other developing countries have been providing South-South climate cooperation. They've been providing finance, but they don't want to put it through the Green Climate Fund, because that sets a precedent in the negotiations that they will be expected to do that in perpetuity. But it doesn't mean that it's not happening. It just means it's not being captured by that central hub where the negotiations are. And so you'll see sort of international efforts being very fragmented. And it's partly because this has become an issue of geopolitics. It's about how do we classify the world and make some countries take on more commitments than otherwise they would. And because we tried so long for, you know, a Kyoto-style agreement where, you know, thou shalt reduce by this much by this year underneath that year, and it'll be negotiated by everyone else to tell you what you're going to do, that countries weren't going to do that. So in Copenhagen, it partly fell apart because Brazil, India, South Africa, and China, the basic countries, said, we are not on board with this. And so since that time, it's become more about classifying the world and seeking competitive advantage in the negotiations than really capturing the extent of efforts happening subnationally, transnationally, and even nationally. The EU is well below its Kyoto target, and we rarely actually congratulate them for that. So it's not a great proxy right now in the negotiations for what's really happening in the world and the extent of what's happening in the world. And I think your two senses of developing countries splitting apart is absolutely bang on. And this started in Copenhagen. And in Paris, they split even more. And I would say there's two reasons. One is that developing countries as a group now just have less to hold them together. I mean, you have China and the Seychelles in the same group of G77, and they have vastly different interests. You have Saudi Arabia and Angola in the same groups, and they have vastly different interests in this. So they're going to break apart, and they've broken into a lot of smaller coalitions, small island states, least developed countries, the African group, and the like-minded developing countries, which is, I'm not entirely sure who all's in it. Their membership has fluctuated, but it's the core of it is China, India, Saudi Arabia, Malaysia. The Philippines is no longer in. And so you see these smaller groupings. And the second reason why those groupings broke apart even more in Paris is that was actually a strategy by some developed countries. So the Philippines left this like-minded developed coalition, rumor has it, you know, no firm evidence, under pressure from the EU and the US. So now they're part of the Climate Vulnerable Forum, so a new coalition. And you saw the US engaging with China to get China to move before Paris on some key things like finance and emissions reductions. So they were already very different than India walking into the Paris conference. So that's why the media was, you know, there was this cartoon about the Paris train, and then there was a big elephant on the tracks that was India. They isolated India before that conference even started, and then further engaged with India to break them apart. So once India was on board, once China was on board, once they made enough concessions to get Saudi Arabia on board, Malaysia's not going to pick a fight with the US. So it was partly because developing countries have vastly different interests, you know. The Saudi Arabia's right to keep its economy going threatens the Maldives' right to exist. And the second is that developed countries were splitting apart these groups very strategically to get their agreement. Developed countries, sorry, mostly US and kind of others. And in terms of the angles dividing, again, that's been going on since about, I'll be really short, this is my dissertation. So dangerous ground, I'll be short. This has been going on about 2007-ish. And so the radical eco-warriors that you mentioned is largely the global justice movement. They came from the anti-free trade, anti-WTO battle in Seattle. That's them. They were going to battle in Seattle and Paris until the terrorist attacks happened. And so it's that you have very different groups in there. So the traditional Angos are the ones saying, yeah, we want to talk about stranded assets. Let's pick that fight. They're deeply embedded in the policy. And then the others are pulling this aside and saying, no, no, climate's a justice issue, or climate is a gender issue. And so there's been a proliferation of the types of social movements that are getting involved now. So the Ango community is even formally divided. So they each have 1 minute to speak. There's the Climate Justice Now group. There's the Climate Action Network group. And they've even sort of been formally dividing themselves within the UN process. And I don't really see that ending anytime soon.
Erin, did you want to?
Yeah, I could add a few things on those. The one about the developing countries and sort of the colonialism of the green, I mean, I'd say there's a very interesting thing there that, you know, I heard from different people from Africa, the Philippines, the Marshall Islands, et cetera. They really see, you know, they're still living with kerosene and candles, which are expensive and have huge health implications for them. And, like, for them, jumping to renewables is going to take them to a place of much more autonomy and control over their future. So while they don't have the technology and they're not going to be the companies bringing it in, I think they see huge opportunities for advancement. What's been talked about for decades about literacy and, you know, access to education and such. And again, the technology world has leapfrogged over and is already there with internet. If they can get the electricity and if they can get the iPad, that's there and opens the world to them. So I think they see clean energy and the advancement of clean energy as just a huge advancement in a whole number of areas for them in a super positive way. And on the geopolitics, like to link to that, John Kerry gave a very interesting discussion about, you know, the price of oil now, $40 oil. Canada's oil sands can't compete at $40 oil. U.S. shale can't compete at $40 oil. The Saudis are going to keep the price down there. That is going to really depress the, you know, the, how long will the corporations operating in Canada, U.S., other places where it's high-cost oil, you know, they're not going to survive, which is going to therefore make the world dependent on the Saudis and the Middle East for cheap oil. And so from a geopolitical situation, you actually want clean energy to advance so that you don't have that power centered in the Middle East. So he talked about it really as, you know, we need this clean energy to march forward to create more peace in the world. So that was an interesting other angle to look at it through. And with the ANGOs, I was part of the ANGO coalition there with the Climate Action Network in Canada. And I would say, you know, people looked at the 1.5, so I haven't done the deep analysis that you have, Jennifer, but they were like, great, this 1.5 means it's got to stay in the ground, and that is just going to fuel us because, you know, there's a five-year time that the countries are going to get together and maybe ratchet up their commitments, and there's a lot of unclear pieces as how that's going to move forward. But the ANGOs are going to drive it. That constituent of the ANGOs, they're going to drive it to keep it in the ground and make it impossible or as difficult as they can to get that oil out of the ground. And that's the part they're going to play in terms of contributing to make sure that we don't go beyond 1.5. So there definitely is a split, but I think like all sort of social movements, you need that whole vast array and everybody plays a different role. So I would say definitely it fueled that more radical element. It fueled them that they are now backed up. It has confirmed what they are saying, keep it in the ground.
I think a contributing factor was, I'll take a moment. I actually was Canada's ambassador to the Marshall Islands, and I doubt if anybody else in the room has been there. And I know Tony DeBroom. He wasn't the foreign minister, but he's essentially the main political operator in a country of about 75,000 people. And he's a very shrewd guy. In fact, the first time I met him, he was talking about using a deep ocean Japanese renewable energy technology because they have not only no fossil fuels, but other than sunshine, no energy source. And it's a country with profound difficulties. But he not alone, Maldives and others in the small island states, but he was extremely visible. There's a profile of him on the front page of the New York Times, and I watched him doing a stand-up event at the German Pavilion, which had a big sign behind it saying, let's keep it to 2%, with Germans falling over themselves, apologizing for the 2% when it should really be 1.5. So anyhow, if you were an astute operator, and there were many astute operators at that forum, they saw their opportunities and they took them. I'm going to take a couple of comments because time is moving on. So, gentleman in the blue shirt, and then we'll go to John at the back, and then I'm going to take reactions here. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you. Yep. Okay. My question is about transportation, particularly international transportation. We have a carbon tax here, and basically it says if you purchase and consume a fossil fuel in BC, you pay the carbon tax. So here we have the harbor just adjacent to us, international ships, cruise ships, merchant ships, who presumably pays carbon tax. Do they or do they not? Okay, we have an aviation, YVR. So all of those planes jetting off internationally, do they pay carbon tax? So here we have, and I can see the shaking of the heads, thank you. Here we have the elephant in the room, two of the largest concentrated sources. Was that touched upon in Paris?
Take a second comment or question, just so we can bundle them.
I'm John Richard, and my comment ties in very nicely to yours. Thank you for having introduced my dour discipline of economics. I desperately hope I'm wrong and that your enthusiasm about a diplomatic breakthrough is right and the dismal science that I supposedly represent is wrong. But on our side of the fence, we believe only in price, ultimately, as what really matters. James Hansen, long-standing grandfather of this whole exercise, going back to the 1980s, testifying in the US Congress, harumphed, it's a fraud. Why? Because there's no real commitment to increasing the price on carbon.
And his proposal is start at $15 a ton, increase by $10 a ton thereafter, with no limit until you really see that things are changing. And that, coincidentally, is what the climate leadership team here in BC recommended, that after we get over Christy Clark's five-year freeze, that we start yanking it up at $10 a ton, and we actually are starting at 30. So I'm very conscious of how difficult this is to do, and your discussion about visiting tourist ships is just one case. What we do about the cement industry is another. It is very, very difficult to rejig a tax system to the extent that it is required if we essentially rely on carbon tax. I'm interested in comments about from the others and to what extent there was realistic discussion about pricing carbon
in Paris.
Take comments on both of those points.
So it did come up, and specifically Jerry Brown talked about how I think it's $14 in California, which is far too low, and he was the first one to admit it. But I didn't hear him suggesting that he was going to increase it anytime soon, and I'm not clear on the whys or the policy behind it. And, you know, clearly even here at $30, twice as much as California, it's still not high enough, and I think that's just been generally acknowledged. And so it has come up, and that's really all I can say. Go ahead.
So, you know, California is $14 because it's a cap and trade system, and it goes on the market and it gets bid, and that's what it gets bid at. So that's what Quebec and California are paying. One, just to say, BC was on the stage numerous times talking about its successful carbon tax. So from the business community, it was talked about over and over again. Bring it on, give it to us. I want that carbon price signal in my financial spreadsheets. That will drive me to make decisions. And without it in there, we keep making bad decisions because there isn't a price signal. But if you look at BC as a case in point, I was on that climate leadership team. We've recommended increasing the carbon tax by $10 a ton. What did the BC Business Council do? They screamed. They said, stop, don't. We don't hear British Columbia's business sector saying, go. And I think this really does come down to the whole public piece and the business community. And I think what we can do here in British Columbia is send the signal to the government, yes, keep it going up. For those of you who don't know, our carbon tax, the way it's structured, is it's revenue neutral. So we pay a carbon tax, and in return, our income tax went down and our corporate tax rate went down. We have the lowest income tax in Canada, the lowest corporate tax rate in Canada, and we pay a carbon tax. So it's not an added on. Most people don't actually understand that we have the lowest tax rates in Canada because we have a carbon tax, and it, you know, more or less it equals out. We have this, you know, through the recession, our GDP continued to grow, and we have one of the strongest economies in Canada, and we have carbon tax. So there's just nothing for British Columbia to say that this is doing us, that we're hard done by with this carbon tax. And in fact, our carbon emissions dropped at twice the rate of the rest of Canada. So the way science works, your science or someone else's science, you can't draw a direct correlation. All you can say is we have a carbon tax and they don't, and our carbon emissions dropped at twice the rate of the rest of Canada. So, you know, there's something that's working there. On a global scale is a different question. How do you get that price signal strong enough? But here in BC, we can continue to have that price signal. But the BC government, I can tell you, having been on the leadership team, and the government has not made a decision, and, you know, was asked in Paris over and over again, and they won't say what they're going to do, and they need to hear from all sectors of society that there's support for it.
Jen, did you want to?
Yeah, I think, so just briefly, so carbon prices is one of the few specific policies where it says, you know, shall pursue domestic measures to meet the goals in your contributions, such as carbon pricing. And I think globally there's, is it 60 now? Countries in the world with some form of a carbon price.
Countries are subnational.
Countries are subnationals. And so part of the reason why prices are so low in the EU, in California, cap and trade systems, is because there's low demand. And so if we are serious now, and if this agreement, I mean, it's a diplomatic breakthrough, but the proof is always in the implementation, right? So if implementation happens, those demand for credits go up. And so I'll defer to you, you're the economist, but I think that means the price goes up. And so let's hope that's the signal. And then maritime and aviation. So one of the downsides of this agreement is that previous drafts up until about the second to last one included a line to deal with international aviation and maritime bunker fuels, essentially. And that's not in there anymore. And so it is the fastest growing source of emissions since the Kyoto Protocol was signed. And right now, it's up to every country to deal with it, whether they're a port state or a flag state. And so the International Maritime Organization and the International Civil Aviation Organization have been trying to do this separately, but it's a really messy process right now. So it is one of the weaknesses.
Out of curiosity, what percentage does that currently represent?
I don't know off the top of my head. I know it's the fact four and a half, five.
I'm going to take a, coming to, and then yet, but we've got a number of comments up, so I'll take them in clusters. Ken, there's some comments on the line. Then I'll go to this gentleman and Michael, and then Paul will come back to you.
Okay, there's two related questions from Twitter, so I'll bundle them together. Nick Waller asks, wondering about the conspicuous, the tweet is from Dwight Owens. What about the detrimental impacts of trade pacts like FIPA, TPP, on national and regional efforts to decarbonize? And related to that, Hem May I Speak asks, can someone speak to Canada's coming relationship with the provinces coming out of COP21?
Great. And Michael, you signaled.
Yeah, we're talking about prices, but we also need to be talking about policy in BC. And particularly in the Lower Mainland, where the vision for the Lower Mainland for the last 40 years, the very successful vision, has been cities in a sea of green. And now what I'm starting to see is a green city in a sea of sprawl. And the best example of it was announced today. Another $3.5 billion for a piece of 1950s technology based on 1950s thinking from Los Angeles, and that's the new Massey Bridge. Vancouver has a somewhat testy relationship with the rest of the Lower Mainland, and how do we bridge that so that we are all moving in the same direction?
Take reactions to those comments from each or any of you.
So TPP, the Comprehensive European Trade Agreement, which actually binds municipalities as well, not just provinces and at the national level, all of those trade agreements were drafted without the environment in mind, without COP21 in mind. Conversely, and someone can help me more with the agreements, but my thinking, my understanding is that as we move towards ratifying these agreements, it's going to have a significant impact on trade. So, there is a big trend on local. Local food is the best example of that, and I think we'll continue to see that sort of those kinds of clusters strengthen as we try to decouple from some of the dependencies in the global trade agreements. But at the same time, what's happening, as we're trying to green up, as we're trying to reduce our environmental footprint, we're seeing more and more free trade agreements come to bear. And this is a big challenge. I don't have the answers, but these two beasts are flying in the face of each other, and it'll be very interesting to see how they play out. Now, locally, again, I don't have the solution, but you would think that if we're all really paying close attention, the province, the metropolitan, and the cities, that we would be extending SkyTrain down to the BC ferries, picking up commuters from Tawasin and Ladner, in other areas instead of a massive 1950s bridge. And we should be seeing that sort of extensions to the North Shore and other areas of the metropolitan area in a positive response, you know, really acknowledging the agreements that are coming out of Paris, and it's not happening. And when we think about the next 35 years and how we're going to become 100% renewable before 2050, we need to be thinking about green infrastructure right now and getting green infrastructure in place before 2030. And if we can't get it in by 2030, we're not going to hit our targets, in my opinion. Yeah. So again, this is not going to be easy. And I'm sorry, I don't have any answers there for you, but those are my comments.
Okay. Maren, do you want to take the comment about Canada, the delegation and the provinces?
Yeah. So coming out of Paris, Trudeau committed that he would meet with the provinces within 90 days. My understanding is that they will be meeting in January, although, you know, I'm not sure that won't get pushed off to February. And what do they need to do? I mean, really, there needs to be, there has never been a plan for Canada as to how, you know, we don't have a national climate plan. Stephen Harper committed at Copenhagen that we would go 17% reduction, but there was never a plan made as to how to do it. So this is going to be the start of making a plan. You know, many people have asked me, well, isn't the plan going to be ready in 90 days? And, you know, I don't know who heard that there was going to be a plan in 90 days. He committed to actually meet with the provinces and start that process. And if there was a plan in 90 days, I don't think it would be a very good one, because it's going to take a lot of coordination. I'm excited that he's actually taking this role, this leadership role, to bring the provinces together, because this is what we need. And we need collaboration between the provinces. You know, there's a lot of good energy in Paris with, you know, the Premier Manitoba was there, Ontario, Quebec. Christy Clark was there for a bit, but the minister was there. Same with Notley was there for a few days, and then the minister was there. So there was a lot of participation and really good synergy. Manitoba's joined the cap and trade program now with Quebec and Ontario. So that's going to be the next steps, is making a plan and collaboration. There's been money put on the table by the feds for infrastructure, which is a key piece that's missing, whether it's transmission lines between provinces or transit systems or electric vehicle infrastructure. Infrastructure is a big piece of this, and cities don't have the money for it. Even the provinces don't really have the money. We really needed the federal government to come to the table and be a contributor. So exactly what that's going to look like, exactly what the timeline is, that those pieces aren't clear, but I think they will get clear. That's what's exciting about 2016. Canada will have a climate plan, and it will be through that process that we potentially will ratchet up our ambition from what it is right now.
So at least we have a plan to have a plan. I'll take two more comments from this gentleman and from Paul Meyer.
Not meaning to be negative, I knew somebody would have to be, is the legally non-binding aspect of everything here. We sort of see a radical ramp up across the world of green, clean energy, while at the same time not a corresponding ramp down of fossil fuels. So we're all on a diet, and as long as we still continue to have five Big Macs for lunch, if we have a salad, it's okay. That's sort of where we are. And granted, we still have a long way to go, and we're a lot further than we've ever been. I went to Copenhagen, and it was a depressing experience. Where do you see the coalescing of the legally binding aspect of all this coming in, if at all? Because that's, I think, the piece that's always going to be necessary. You know, please don't rob people, but if you do, nothing much happens. Doesn't stop people from robbing people. We need to do something like that.
Thanks. Question to Jennifer, just what flexibility is there in that 2020 date for entering the force? If the ratification process goes more quickly, is it possible to have those commitments, in a sense, be initiated earlier than the 2020 window? And if you could also to comment about the reporting requirements under the new agreement and your sense of how effective they will be. Thanks.
Actually, I'll ask Jennifer maybe to reply to those questions and then invite our other panelists to comment and react to your point as well about the legal agreement, as well as are we really off fossil fuels or moving off fossil fuels?
So this is a legally binding agreement. The question is, what's legally binding? So the legally binding parts are transparency, so reporting, are having this global stock stake. So the whole transparency cycle is legally binding. Basically, the whole accountability apparatus of this agreement is legally binding. Countries have a legally binding obligation to provide finance. They also have a legally binding obligation to prepare, maintain, and communicate these nationally determined contributions. So what is not legally binding is the actual content of those contributions. So that's the wrinkle. And in part, that's because you have 190-odd countries, and so you can't say to the Marshall Islands, you have to have the same sort of target as the United States of America. But it's also because otherwise you simply would not get countries to do this. And so it's legally binding mostly. The other part is the compliance, and I think that's maybe where you were getting. So what happens if a country does not meet its legally binding commitment? So this compliance mechanism in the new agreement is weaker than the one in Kyoto. So the Kyoto Protocol has a double compliance mechanism, a facilitative branch, how can we help you comply, and an enforcement branch, that's the stick, how can we make you comply. But in practice, you know, it's, I don't have kids, but I'm told it's like if you have a bunch of toddlers in a sandbox and you say, just make your own rules and then don't tell me if no one follows them. So, you know, I'm told. So I think it's that's basically what happened. There, you know, countries that didn't meet their Kyoto obligations, that, you know, nothing really bad happened. So it's one of these things where I think it's a bit of a red herring to say we need a legally binding agreement, because frankly, no one is going to pull out that trade sanction stick just in case next time you're more than happy to use it on them. So I'm more concerned personally about how can we ramp up action than worrying about how do we enshrine it in a legally binding document. And I think that's maybe a bit of a sad state of the state of climate governance right now, that's where we're at, but it's also hopefully a starting point.
And on ratification question.
And on ratification. So 55 countries representing 55 emissions, what happens if that's before 2020? I don't know if anyone actually asked themselves that question when they were drafting this. So as I read it, if you get the 55 and 55 before 2020, this thing could enter into force. I don't know if that's a good thing in some way. I think it'd be okay, because there's this laundry list of things. There's things that they're going to do to make sure that once this thing enters into force, it can hit the ground running. So setting up the rules for the new market mechanism that this agreement established. Setting up the rules for how to account for the provision and mobilization of public finance. Setting up, there's all these methodologies and modalities that they're going to work on before the agreement enters into force. And there's a facilitative dialogue to do a take stock starting next year. So those things are all moving parts. And so if this enters into force early, those moving parts won't be in place. And countries then will be scrambling to make sure that their NDCs, these contributions, are in place as well. So I think earlier in 2020 would be fine if it was maybe 2017-ish, 2018, when some of these modalities were in place. But I think actually countries won't ratify until they see what some of those rules look like. So what will the rules for this new market mechanism be? Might really matter for, say, Europe. They didn't even really have a good name for it yet. And so I think there is some flexibility there, but I think countries might be a little hesitant to jump on that bandwagon and really start to ratify until they see what some of these rules look like. And the reporting requirements, they are legally binding. It's sort of this common template, so everyone must report. Developed countries have very stringent things that they must report, but everyone has the same general laundry list that they have to report. And then there's capacity building to help countries report. You know, you can't expect a least developed country to be providing the same sort of information as Canada. So there's significant capacity building pieces that help countries meet this legally binding reporting obligation as well. And so the transparency is actually quite good. You're going to hear from every country on what they're doing.
We're getting close to our end. So I'm not seeing any, okay, one hand up at the back. So a couple more. So I'll take very quick comments and then we'll invite our panelists to make some closing remarks. Great. There.
I think this the outcome of COP21 is beyond my wildest dreams. And I felt, I think, along with a lot of other people in Canada and the world, this great sense of hope and possibility that just didn't feel like it was there before. So great. Thank you, all of you who went and duked it out. And I want to thank all of the people who did civil disobedience as well. Let's not cut them off and say that's not okay, because without them, we wouldn't be here today. I think the problem that we're going to run into is that the international trade agreements have enforcement mechanisms whereby investors can take their complaints. Let's say they bought drilling rights for drilling a gas well in northeastern BC, and then BC says, well, we've decided that technology is too polluting, so we're not going to let you do it. Well, we taxpayers are going to end up paying those investors for not drilling. And there is no enforcement mechanism in COP21, as far as I can tell, though there is language about it being legally binding. And maybe if we just talk about that a lot, and everyone comes to believe that that's how it is, that will give it more power. But I think that's kind of, that's where the money, one of the places the money issue comes in, and the trade agreements come in that you've been talking about that constrain municipalities in signing contracts for green projects because of trade agreements that say, well, if you do that, you're gonna have to pay somebody who invested in a dirty technology that they were going to sell you in their bidding. Well, we'll have to pay them if we don't take that dirty technology. That's where we are, and we need to get out of that.
Last couple of comments, I think, over here. Were there any other hands up that I saw? Yep, here. Just going to take them. Yes, the gentleman with the... Sorry. We're not doing it in the most efficient fashion, but as I see people, go ahead.
Thank you very much. I'm just curious how much detail some of the discussions went into. There's obviously the central core that can stay at the high level of temperature, the outer circle that goes in and says we have a plan or a plan to make a plan, and how can the agreements at the higher level be made without the more detailed plan, and how far did those discussions go? For example, in BC, we have a climate leadership report, which is a plan recommending, for example, passive homes paying to pollute for CNG, but zero emission vehicle mandate for electric vehicles, but no infrastructure for them. So there's, you know, still wrinkles in those plans, but at the next level, did those details get fed back into the overall that roll up into the ability to make the commitment at the higher level, or was the whole Paris thing at such the high level, which is essential first, to have that high level commitment before we get into the details?
Okay. And if I could just ask you to be, last person, brief comment or question, so we can.
Sure, I think one thing that's important is just to make sure we in Vancouver and BC are on a similar page of what we want to see from the new climate leadership plan. Are there any plans to get folks together just to make sure we support each other's recommendations on that?
You're afraid of the BC?
Yeah, the BC plan. Yeah.
Great. So I'll ask our panelists to respond to those questions and offer any other final comments you may not have had a chance to make. Maybe I'll do it from my left to the right. So Brian, Marin, and then concluding with Jennifer.
I'm not sure I understood the question over there.
The question was whether there's any plans for people to get together to, and I guess I infer in civil society, to help support an outcome of BC's 2.0 plan, and presumably one that's consistent with the intentions and maybe better than the agreement that was global agreement that was reached in Paris.
Yeah. You know, I talked a little bit before about how proud I am to be a Vancouverite, and that's one of the reasons is because of the leadership that's been shown at City Council, and you know, quite frankly, it's been happening since the 1970s with organizations like Greenpeace, which were founded here. And when I go around the world and I talk and promote Vancouver as a place to do business, people don't even know that Greenpeace is from Vancouver, let alone some of the other great organizations. But so where I'm going with that is that we, you know, I appreciate the comments about getting on with planning, but quite frankly, in my world, businesses are not waiting. We promote our businesses as, you know, the true agents for change. So the governments are going to plod along and continue to provide frameworks that are critical and important. And simultaneously, businesses as agents of change are trying to get ahead of some of that because it's a market opportunity, it's a business opportunity, and it's the right thing to do. So, you know, at the Economic Commission, we're continuing to try and enable and support those companies that want to be free and unencumbered and just get going and get on with it, despite how slow things are moving elsewhere at the government level.
Yeah, so during the Paris COP, I don't know if any of you saw the photos of Beijing and the air quality in Beijing. So I use that as a symbol, like legally binding, not legally binding. That's not the driver. It's, you know, these people need to breathe. They are going to change, and they've been shifting out coal to solar and wind, and it's now the cars. There's so many cars. They are now investing in electric vehicles because they have to. You know, that's a country that has lived through revolution. These people know how to revolt, and you can't tell people to stay at home weeks on end. And so the government's going to act, and that's going to drive the price of electric vehicles down. And so, you know, I go, Kyoto was legally binding, and what good did that do? Like, I don't think it's about legally binding. There's a role for it, but the business case, I mean, the businesses were really clear. We are ahead of the governments. There is a business case now, and we're going to go in there, and we are going to compete, and we are going to drive down the prices of this, and you're going to be buying these technologies because they're better and they're going to be cheaper. And whether there's a standard or a thing, I think these international trade agreements are going to be a challenge, and I don't have enough knowledge about them in the detail and what we're going to need to do, but I don't think in the end of the day, I'd say over the next 5 years, they're going to be a challenge. But they will get unhinged because this other force will be going. And so there's a great story that Al Gore told. You know, he said in 1989, AT&T looked at the situation and was like, oh, you know, there's these cell phones. Remember cell phones in 1989? They're about this big. And, you know, but we can see something's happening. So they commissioned a study and said, you know, by the year 2000, how many cell phones will we be selling? We need to be prepared for this new market. Whoever was hired, McKinsey or KPMG or whoever, you know, and they came back and they said 100,000 cell phones will be sold in the year 2000. So year 2000 hit, 100,000 cell phones were sold in about the first 60 hours, I think it was, of the year 2000. And, you know, that's the story. What's going to happen in the year 2025 in terms of electric vehicles, in terms of, you know, PV, home solar systems, PV and a storage unit. I think it's going to be exciting. Yeah. When it comes to the BC thing, I need people to understand what the climate leadership team gave some recommendations. It's not a plan. The government does not have a plan. They were supposed to take those recommendations and turn them into a plan before Paris. They didn't. It is not clear what they're doing. That's why I truly, truly encourage you to write to your MLA, to the Premier, and to the Minister. They need to hear from people. We expected a plan, a progressive plan that was going to have us meet our climate targets. We do not have a plan. The emissions in British Columbia right now are going up. They are not going down anymore. Because the carbon tax was frozen, everything was frozen. There has not been one new climate policy in BC since 2008. And so BC and British Columbians still think we're leaders. And, you know, they will fight you, the government. I've had this conversation with them. They're like, Alberta's not a leader. You know, they barely met us. They're, you know, just about to get equal with us. Well, guess what? It's 2015 and they just made all those decisions. They are the leader. You are not the leader anymore. But they are coasting because what they say to me is, this does not get brought up. None of my constituents ever bring this up. I get letters about pipelines, but whatever. Pipelines are not about climate change. They do not make that connection. So I really do encourage you to make it, because we all do make a difference, and those letters will make a difference. And they are saying there will be a consultation. You should write to them and get them to put you on a list. It's unclear what that consultation is going to be, but allegedly there's going to be one between now and March.
Gee, Maren, wasn't there already a consultation? I responded to your invitation to reply to it. But
yes.
Anyhow, that will be a good topic for next year. I'll give the last word to Jennifer Allen.
I think actually my last comments sort of feed into this. So we're in this bottom-up world where every country says, here's what I'm promised to do. And this changes the game from, you know, thou shalt do this. And it changes the game in ways that matter for us. So civil society needs to take this mobilization, take everything that Paris just achieved, and say, okay, Canada, BC, we're going to hold you to this. You know, because internationally they may not hold you to this and say, oh, you missed your target. Well, that part wasn't legally binding. So it's up to civil society to make sure that this is going to be met, that there will be demand for action. Because the content of these contributions isn't legally binding, whether or not that matters. So it really changes the game to keep the pressure at home, to talk to your ministers, to talk to your federal counterpart ministers, and say, look, this does matter. It's not just a name change, it's the Ministry of Environment and Climate Change. It means that you're going to be dealing with climate change. And I think this also matters in terms of the level of detail that you were talking about. The Paris Agreement isn't incredibly detailed, because so much of that detail is coming in these contributions. And so in some ways that's good. It means the country can do what's best for it and what matters for it, rather than a cookie cutter template. But it also means that nationally we need to have really difficult conversations about exactly what those details are and how that matters. And how we count up all these things. You know, are we counting removals from forests? And to what extent does that matter? So there's a lot of details really to be worked out. And feeding into this meeting that's supposed to happen with the premiers, I mean, personally, my hope is that we don't worry about what the target should be and what the number is, that we worry about first getting a plan. Because often there's so much conversation about, well, should it be 30% or 25 or 40? Let's make sure we can hit one of those because our plan internationally is not super ambitious. I think it's, 30% below 2005 or something. Let's make sure we can hit something. And then let's figure out the number and make that number more ambitious as we go. Because often you spend 6 months worrying about a number without making a plan. And so I think, again, this is that bottom-up world where we need to sort of figure out as a country and as a community and as a province what we're going to do.
Thank you very much. I think we'll conclude there. Let me just say a couple of words. Your last point was actually echoed by one of our earlier carbon talks, Martin Parkinson, talking about Australia's misadventures in carbon pricing, and that was one of his takeaways. Design a process before you get hung up on a number. I'd like to thank again our sponsors for these talks, which are all videotaped and archived, North Growth Foundation, PICS, Pacific Institute of Climate Solutions, and SFU Center for Dialogue. The next one will be in January 27th. It'll be on decarbonization, a very important topic for the future, offered by Carbon Management Canada, and I invite you to continue to come. Lastly, please congratulate our panelists.